Additionally, this is not a long-term solution because these chemicals must be applied every few months or so, depending on the type of chemical. And finally, it's not cost-effective. For example, one water treatment plant in the Great Lakes spends anywhere from $480,000 to $500,000 to treat their zebra mussels. And this is just one plant. So I decided to look at zebra mussel attachment. See, zebra mussels secrete a Bissell thread, which is made out of collagen, and this allows them to attach to a variety of different surfaces, and is a key factor for why there are such a successful invasive species. Additionally, zebra mussels have to secrete a Bissell thread in order to filter feed. Therefore, I thought to explore different surfaces with the idea that if I could develop a surface that best prohibits zebra mussels from attaching, wouldn't that solve the problem? Plus, it would be environmentally friendly, it would be long-term, and therefore it would also be cost-effective. So, in the first year of my project, my hypothesis was that if there is a texture chosen, specifically the fish scale surface, and in the second year of my research, it was the alternating surface, if that was chosen as a substrate, then the number of attacked zebra mussels would decrease. Conversely, my null hypothesis was that the surface does not affect the number of attacked zebra mussels. So first, I had to collect these organisms from the Clinch River, which is very close to Knoxville. I put the mussels in a holding tank, and then I was able to marry my interest for both marine biology and emerging technology. So what I did was I coded, designed, and 3D printed several different surfaces, like the one on the podium over there, and the ones right here. I placed these mussels on the surfaces, observed their attachment, and analyzed my results. Let's look at the surfaces I used in the first round of my experiments. So I created 5 different surfaces in the form of dishes. My first one was smooth, which was my standard of comparison. Second was lines, which were parallel lines. The third were perpendicular lines, known as grid. Then I had high-low and fish scale. I placed 15 mussels on each surface, and I recorded their attachment for 15 days, looking at the mussels attached to the surface. And I categorized an attachment by if the mussels secreted a Bissell thread and formed an attachment. I also looked at the mussels attached to another organism, another mussel, because going back to an earlier slide, when they clog pipes, they tend to also attach to other mussels, clogging the entire pipe. I looked at if they had no attachment at all, and I looked for if they attached to the smooth part of the surface. And these are my results, as you can see here depicted on the bar graph. I also used a student t-test to find the p-values of each surface, comparing each surface to my standard of comparison, my smooth surface. And what I found was the grid surface was the most disruptive surface. Additionally, the grid surface made its first attachment on day 9 out of 15. However, going back to the student t-test, it was not technically statistically significant because the p-value was 0.096 for the grid surface, and to be significant, it must be 0.05 or lower. Therefore, I went and tested a new round. And so in the second phase of my project, I kept a few things the same. So I still have my smooth, grid, and line surfaces, but this time I placed them inside the inside of a pipe to better accurately represent what zebra mussels, you know, how they attach in the wild. Next, I tried to better emulate a natural river setting. So I have 2 water pumps, I use river water collected from the actual Tennessee River so that the pHs and nitrogen levels, the temperatures, match up as well as possible. However, I did have one spike in temperature that I will discuss in a little bit. And finally, I increased the sample size to 70 mussels per pipe, and I ran the experiment for 37 days. And these are my results. So looking at each pipe, and comparing that to my standard of comparison, I looked at it both as a bar graph and as a scatter plot to look at the correlation constant, and the linear regression. And I did this for all surfaces. In my data calculations, I calculated the linear regression to calculate the differences in rate of decline of muscle attachment, as well as the average number of muscles attached, the percent attached, and the standard error of statistic, which I used to analyze my data. Since the populations were independent and they were a non-Gaussian distribution, that is why I used this statistical test. Now, looking at the percent attached, the alternating surface had the least percent attached, therefore it was the most disruptive. At the same time, when calculating the standard error statistic, the alternating surface's standard error statistic was the greatest, therefore it was the most disruptive. And so this is what I concluded after looking at the means of attachment, percent attached, and standard error statistic. I concluded that while the line surface was the least disruptive, the alternating surface was in fact the most disruptive surface. Therefore, the null hypothesis was rejected, but my alternate hypothesis, which was, if a surface is chosen, specifically the alternating surface, then the number of attacked zebra mussels will decrease. And my data supported that. Finally, to address the fluctuations in water temperature, I found that zebra mussels that attached to the alternating and grid surfaces were most negatively affected by a sudden increase in water temperature. Honestly, the implications of this research are immense, because taking the simple idea of a textured surface that can be used to prohibit zebra mussels from forming attachments is so powerful. So it can be used, as in my project, to be a pipeliner, to line the insides of pipes to deter mussel attachment that way. At the same time, it can be placed on the bottom of boats and in docks. Now, looking ahead, the amount of surface that will have this texture on it can also be experimented with, as you can see in this diagram right here. In fact, in the future, I'd like to discover what is that optimum length in which drag is reduced, yet the number of zebra mussels that are attached also goes down. I mean, currently, zebra mussels clog entire pipes, so even if a surface will create drag, it will be so much less drag than a pipe that is completely blocked by mussels. Second, I've been looking at this problem from a physical level, but I want to look at this problem at a chemical level too, specifically looking at zebra mussels' DOPA bonds that they make when they attach to these surfaces. Lastly, I think the pipes could be placed in the actual Tennessee River. Now, during the second round of my project, I originally tried doing this, but unfortunately, the swift Tennessee River carried my pipes away. However, you know, in the future, I would like to look at rivers such as the Clinch River, which may not have that high of water current, and so I'm looking into that. Before I take any questions, I do want to point out that I am on the third phase of this research, which is very similar to my second, but I'm using a slightly different plastic. Also, I have added two more surfaces. And I think it just goes to show that my favorite part about research is the fact that there are never a lack of variables to consider. I have really enjoyed working with this project for the last 2 years, and I plan on continuing my work. So I would now take questions.
So these zebra mussels, if you prevent them to anchor on the surface, will it affect their biology or their livelihood or anything, or they will just go and find another surface?
All right, so the question to the audience, I'm going to repeat it, was, will deterring zebra mussel attachment affect their survival? So it will affect their survival in the pipes, because without attaching, they're not able to filter feed. And filter feeding is critical to their survival. Now, yes, they can always go and attach to a rock nearby. Usually adult zebra mussels can remove attachment and form new attachment within 24 hours. But my project specifically focuses on the problems that these mussels create by clogging pipes, because that causes so much economic damage. So yes, to answer your question.
So for the first phase, you said you looked at it for like 15 days, and the second one was 37 or so. So how do you come up with those time frames of like you used that?
All right, so I used 15 during the first, because that was a good enough time for the number of mussels that I had, right? And the second round, because I had 70 mussels, and you know, I had learned from prior experiences, I was able to take care of them for a longer time. However, by 37 days, a lot of them have simply started dying, whether it was due to a lack of food or just because they're in a different environment. So I would have loved to extend that project even further, but they unfortunately started dying. I did it on the 3D printer was every single pipe has the same outside diameter, so they all have a smooth pipe going outside. Inside, they all have the same diameter as well, and so yes, all the textures will have the same height. And that's why I want to view this problem as both physically and chemically, because right now, zebra mussels, the actual attachment isn't really that much deterred by the different surfaces. Rather, it's how their bodies are oriented in the grooves. And so that is most effective. And I think what you brought up is really great, because varying that is also going to affect how much drag that's created. So I definitely, after, you know, narrowing down to a surface or two, I would definitely look into the height of that as my next step too.
And what are the two new textures?
So the two new textures I have are spiraling, and I got that idea actually when I entered at Johns Hopkins and I was talking to my mentor, and he suggested that with the idea of it may change the water velocity. But what I found actually through other research is a higher water velocity, it's harder for zebra mussels to make that initial attachment. But it's a paradox, because once they make that attachment, if they're successful, higher water velocity means they get more food faster as filter feeders. But I'm currently in that right now. And then my other surface are small pyramids.
Instead of looking at the cylinder, is it possible to have a rectangle or do you have a square and all that?
Right, I think those are definitely possibilities. And the question was, could we look at the pipes in different forms, such as a square or rectangle? However, a circular pipe is what is most commonly used in industry, and so that is why I wanted to make my research as applicable as possible to the real world, and that is why I use a circular, although I'm sure a square and rectangle could definitely affect it.
So the material that you use to make this pipe, mm-hmm. are you going to vary this plastic, metal, etc. Number one, and number two, although you have these alternate glues, in practical life, it might get silt in the water, there could be deposit. That needs to be tested also, right? Because that might give easy anchor point.
Absolutely. And I've actually thought about both of your questions. So to answer the first one, which was talking about the actual material. So in the first two rounds, I've used PLA plastic, polyactive plastic, and that is obviously non-toxic. In this third round, I'm using ABS plastic, which is more commonly known as Lego plastic. So I am working with two different types of plastic,